हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू माय क्लास। ओके, इन दिस क्वांटम मैकेनिक्स सीरीज, इन द आइडेंटिकल पार्टिकल चैप्टर, इन द लास्ट क्लास वी हैव सीन द राइटिंग ए वेव फंक्शन फॉर ए टू पार्टिकल सिस्टम। ओके, सो द फाइन टुडे विल डिस्कस वन ऑफ द इंपॉर्टेंट प्रॉब्लम, दैट इज हाइड्रोजन मॉलिक्यूल। हाइड्रोजन मॉलिक्यूल, सो दिस इज हाइटलर लंडन ट्रीटमेंट। हाइटलर लंडन ट्रीटमेंट, ओके। दिस इज द थ्योरी जनरली केमिस्ट्री पीपल विल स्टडी टू अंडरस्टैंड द बॉन्डिंग, टू अंडरस्टैंड द केमिकल बॉन्डिंग इन ए मॉलिक्यूल। ओके, सो लेट अस सी हियर, विल राइट द श्रोडिंगर वेव इक्वेशन एंड विल ट्राई टू कंस्ट्रक्ट द वेव फंक्शन, ओके, एंड ऑल दोस थिंग्स। सो हाउ मेनी टर्म्स विल बी देयर इन द हैमिल्टोनियन, so then interaction and atom, and how many terms will be considered here and how many will ignore, why will ignore, all those things will be I'll discuss here. Okay, fine. So everybody knows that a hydrogen molecule, there will be two hydrogen atoms, the hydrogen atom plus hydrogen atom will be the hydrogen molecule. In an hydrogen atom, everybody knows that there is a nucleus, that is inside the nucleus there is a proton, then around this proton then electron will be revolving. Remember, proton is a fermion, electron is a fermion, both are of spin half particles, both are of spin half particles. Now I have in hydrogen molecule two hydrogen atoms will be there. So let us will write like this. So it consists of two hydrogen nuclei and electrons, two electrons. It consists of two hydrogen nuclei. Nuclei means here it is a proton. Let us say, for example, I'll name it as A and B, and two electrons one and two. So remember, here they are identical. Remember, they are identical. We cannot say that this is A and this is B. Just for writing purpose, like let's say I'll write the potential, then I'll ignore this distinguishability. They are indistinguishable. So that means there is a nuclei, the first hydrogen atom and second hydrogen atom, named it as A and named it as B, and there are two electrons. Let us name one electron as okay, so electrons will be there. Let's say this is the one electron and this is the another electron. So you can name this is the first electron that belongs to the first hydrogen atom and this is the second electron. Okay, fine. So some things will be required here. Some geometry structure is required that I'll write here. The distance from here to here, let us put with the dotted lines all the distances. Call it as RA1. the distance from here to here, or position vector, we can call it as rb2. The distance from here to here, electron to electron, call it as r12. So the distance from here to here, call it as AB. Now the pending will be the diagonals. Pending will be the diagonals. So name this diagonal as RA2. Name this diagonal as RB1. Okay, every letter for me it is important. Then I'll write what is that importance and all those things. Okay. So finally, hydrogen atom consists two H2. Hydrogen atom consists one proton and one electron. But hydrogen molecule consists two hydrogen atoms. There means totally two protons and two electrons. Yeah. So one of the important point I'll write here. That important point will be. The two atoms repel each other if the spins of the two electrons are parallel, and the two atoms attract each other if the spins of the two electrons are anti-parallel. Let me write this statement. The two atoms repel each other if the spins of two electrons are parallel, and the two atoms attract each other, if the spins of two electrons are anti-parallel. So that means whether they are attracted or repelled, that is simply decided by repel each other. When the two spins are, if the two spins of atoms are parallel, and the two atoms attract each other, if the spins of the two electrons are anti-parallel. Okay, this is a important conclusion you need to remember here. But of course, we'll neglect the spin-orbit interaction. So this is the case: first electron and second electron, they are paralleling, and this is the case of repulsion. If one electron will be spin like this, another electron will be like this. They attract. Okay. So, okay, fine. After noting this point, let us write the important thing is that is Schrodinger wave equation. In the Schrodinger wave equation, we need to express all the terms. Right, we'll write the time independent, that is stationary state. Time independent Schrodinger wave equation we'll write. The first term, it consists generally for one dimensional case, in general we'll write d square psi by dx square plus 2m by h crut square e minus b into psi will be is equal to 0. This is the thing we'll write. But what about for a three dimensional case? So this will be replaced with the del square psi plus 2m by h square into, we need to express that interaction energy, E minus V into psi will be is equal to 0. So kinetic energy term and potential energy term, that is the total energy, is equal to E psi will write, and that's what we have actually they rearranged. So let's see here, we'll write what is the Schrodinger wave equation for this hydrogen molecule. So that will be as follows. It will be like this: del square psi plus डेल स्क्वायर साई प्लस टू एम एच स्क्वायर ई माइनस वी इंटू साई विल बी इज इक्वल टू जी. सो व्हाट आर दिस टू थिंग्स? दिस इज फॉर हाइड्रोजन एटम वन and this is for hydrogen atom 2. Okay, so that means you can say this is for the first electron kinetic energy and this is for second electron kinetic energy. We can assume that key the protons will be at rest, only electrons are moving. So this is the first electron kinetic energy and that will be the second electron kinetic energy. Okay, this is the kinetic energy of the first electron and this is the kinetic energy of the second electron. Now the important thing will be the V we need to write here. V, what is V here? This is V is the interaction energy. V is the interaction energy. Interaction energy. So that interaction energy will write it. So how many interactions are possible here? The number of interactions will be possible. So a simple formula you always is like, you know very well, this there is a charge of q1 and let's say there is another charge of q2 separated by a distance of some d. The potential energy between them is given by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 divided by d. This is the formula, everybody knows it. Okay, fine. I'm sorry. Yeah. So now write here. Now write here for V. Now write for here V. Here V consists how many terms? And let's see that we'll write here. Just a second. Yes, fine. Yeah. We'll see the interaction energy. So total interaction energy terms will be, there are 6 terms will be there. The first. So VA, first hydrogen atom nucleus and that electron plus second hydrogen atom nuclei and that corresponding electron too. Then next, first hydrogen atom nuclei, second electron B and 1, that cross terms, the diagonal terms will go over. Then electron-electron interaction. Then nucleus-nucleus interaction. Okay. So each and every term this can be. This is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught is common everywhere, remember. So proton and electron both have the same charges, E square divided by Ra1, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught is there, that is compulsory, in everything it is there. B2, that is also E square divided by Rb2, A2 diagonal term, that is E square divided by Ra2, this is E square divided by Rb1, then electron, E square divided by R12. This is proton and proton. E square divided by Rab. But here, what I do here, I'll ignore all these terms. Perturb terms. So ignore all these things. So this will be like we can consider. But it is a tedious job to calculate the simplification and all those things. This can be done by perturbation theory. So by using perturbation theory, we can consider this also. So this we left for the perturbation theory. That is the next chapter. So perturbation theory can be used to understand this. Perturbation theory can be used to understand this. Okay, I'll ignore this. So the finally, we can write the Schrodinger wave equation will be like this. That is the first electron kinetic energy term. the second electron plus 2m by h cut square e minus, we need to write that energy, e minus v, that is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Of course, there's a proton is positive and that is attractive potential. So that I write here, that is v a 1 minus v a 2 will be into psi is equal to 0. So we need to solve this. So solving this is easy because it has a two independent differential equations. Okay, so the solution is easy to way of solve. Then we can break up into two parts. So we need to solve this. We need to solve this. See, the solution of this will be, so both are there, both the electrons, first electron and second electron. Okay, this can be written as, for a first electron and second electron, 1 and 2, it is a function. That is psi a 1, psi b 2. Also, this is correct option. Even another correct option, psi will be is equal to psi a 2, psi b 1. This is another correct option also. Okay, as the particles are identical and indistinguishable, we cannot say this is the first particle and this is the second particle. This is one particle and this is the other particle. So obviously we know that in any system we required, it is a perfectly symmetric system, totally symmetric function or totally asymmetric function. Like we need to construct here, so totally symmetric or asymmetric? Totally symmetric or anti-symmetric ends. Asymmetric functions are required. Anti-symmetric functions are required. Okay. So, because there are the two electrons and two protons will be there, every particle will have the spin. So, the total spin can be of a boson type or the total spin can be of a, like say if there are four spins will be there, all can be of then boson family, three up, one down, still it will be a boson family, two up, two down, still boson family, like three up and down, this is the boson family. So finally, the hydrogen molecule, H2 molecule, will come under boson family. If it is come under boson family, we need to construct the symmetric wave function. So let's see symmetric wave function. Remember here, the total wave function consists two parts. The total wave function consists two parts. The total wave function consists the two parts. That is, one is of space dependent wave function. Another one will be the spin dependent wave function. Okay. So we need to construct both space dependent and spin dependent. For a symmetric, you can take both symmetric. Symmetric multiplied by symmetric as asymmetric. So this is symmetric and this is symmetric. No issues. The product will come as symmetric. Or else this is antisymmetric and this is antisymmetric. The product again will come as symmetric. So now we need to construct symmetric and anti-symmetric space functions as well as spin functions. So that is even done in the previous session also. I repeat again here. So finally, for space part, I'll go for the space part. So psi symmetric function can be written as, so of course normalization constants we can need to add. Remember, the particles are quantum particles, that is identical and indistinguishable particles, plus psi a 2 psi b 1. See, under the particle interchange 1 and 2, it will be symmetric wave function. Then what about for asymmetric wave function? That asymmetric wave function, so let us better we write here capital A because small a is already used. Asymmetric function, so will be is equal to a1 and b2 minus a2 b1. This is the space part. Now we need to consider the spin part. Let us consider the spin part. Yeah, so the spin part, so it can be symmetric or anti-symmetric. For symmetric, it can be of, let's say, spin up state of first electron and spin up state of second electron. This is one possibility. Then what is another possibility? Spin down state of first particle and spin down state of second particle. Then what is the other possibility? Alpha 1 beta 2 plus beta 1 alpha 2. Alpha means, you remember, it is a spin up state, half. Beta is the spin down state, half minus half. Okay, I hope this is clear. Okay, these are the three possibilities for the symmetric part. But asymmetric part, there is only one part. For asymmetric part, it will be of alpha 1, first particle in spin up state and second particle in spin down state minus beta 1 alpha 2. This is the anti-symmetric. There is only one possibility for anti-symmetric. So now you can substitute for the total wave function. It is a orbital as well as spin. Okay, that we have already written here. The total wave function consists like this. So this is the way of constructing the wave function for a hydrogen molecule. Okay, so if it is an hydrogen ion instead of molecule, let's say we have written further this entire story for the hydrogen molecule. Then, so this is the Heitler-London treatment. Okay, that is, he ignore all these things. That is, we are ignoring all these four terms. We are taking only two terms. Okay, this is the valence band theory type. Yeah, what about if hydrogen ion, H2 ion? So the same thing we can write here for the hydrogen ion. H2 ion. So that means one electron is removed. So one electron is removed. Now I have only, so first hydrogen atom, second hydrogen atom, they are the nuclei. Now we have only one electron. So one electron. Now how many terms will be possible in the interaction energy? Three terms will be possible. This and this, and this and this, and this and this. So that is, in interaction energy, three terms will be possible. A and electron will interact, B and electron will interact, plus AB also will interact. So we ignore this. So B will become, then first and this will electron will interact. So VAE plus VB. So now Schrodinger wave equation as usual. Now there is only one electron, so this will be of, that is del square psi plus 2 m by h square into e minus of, that is a plus a with e and b with e into psi will be is equal to 0. Then again we need to construct the psi here for this system. Then what about here, whether it is symmetric wave function is required or asymmetric wave function is required? Here it is only three particles are there. All three can be in the spin up state. All three can be in the spin down state. So two can be upper state and one can be down state. Or otherwise, one up state and two down state. Wherever you go, it will come as half integral spins. So half integral spins will come. So wherever you go, it will be of half integral spins will come. So that means this system of hydrogen molecule, hydrogen ion, is a fermion family. If it is a fermion family, that psi we need to construct, the total wave function we need to construct will be of asymmetric function. If it is an asymmetric function, then there is a space part and spin part. Space part and spin part. So, completely asymmetric. The space part. So, this is the space part and this will be the spin part. So, that means here asymmetry we need to get. So, the only way to get asymmetry will be space part is asymmetric, then this must be symmetric. If it is of symmetric and this must be of asymmetric. This is the way we will get hydrogen ion wave function. Okay. So, whether it is a hydrogen molecule or hydrogen ion, whatever it may be, we can easily construct the wave function of for that system. Because as it is a symmetrization principle says that key, any system, if it is belongs to a fermion family, it must be totally anti-symmetric wave function. If it is belongs to a boson family, the total wave function must be a symmetric. Okay. I hope it is clear. Then what is Heitler-London treatment of hydrogen molecule? Okay, it is a mostly the chemistry people will study it is more clearly to understand the chemical bonding. Okay, now let's see the rotational and vibrational energies of a hydrogen molecule. You see it. You see the rotational and this is already done in our first quantum mechanics course, but still anyway, I'll write here. That is rotational energy of a diatomic molecule. Rotational energy of diatomic molecule, that is H2 molecule. So, hydrogen also consists of the two molecules. So, that's why it is the rotational energy of a molecule. So, there will be a situation will be like this. First molecule, let's say it will have the mass A. Diatomic molecule. This is the second atom of mass B, and of course there will be a center of mass, not necessarily at the midpoint. Let's say this is the rotating about its own center of mass axis. It is rotating about its own axis with an angular speed omega. Let's say the distance between them is, you can consider it will be of some d. So you can write the distances will be, this is of Ra and this is of Rb. Here Ra plus Rb will be is equal to d. Even of course Ra, location of the center of mass from A, Ra will be is equal to Mb divided by Ma plus Mb into d. Rb will be is equal to Ma divided by Ma plus Mb into d. So that is a rotational energy. We need to write for the rotational energy. We know that rotational energy, the rotational energy is given by the rotational energy of the system is given by the rotational energy E will be is equal to L square divided by 2i, where L is the orbital angular momentum, I will be the moment of inertia about center of mass. Moment of inertia about an axis passing through the center of mass. It's one axis, about an axis passing through the center of mass. So, moment of inertia that will become here, I will be, in terms of the reduced mass, we can write it will be like this. I will become, that is mu multiplied by d square, where mu is the reduced mass, that can be written as ma mb divided by ma plus mb into d square. So where mu is the reduced mass, that is ma mb divided by ma plus mb. Reduced mass of the system. Okay, fine. Now you see here one of the important thing, it consists the L square term. That is L square term will be the orbital angular momentum. This angular momentum we have already done, that is a ridge rotator, in our first quantum mechanics course. Then it has eigenvalues, that is very well known for us. So the eigenvalues of L square are, so what are the eigenvalues of L square will be h square L into L plus 1. Okay, that is what it means. When L square operator operates on psi, I'll get the h square L into L plus 1 into psi. This we know already. This is the eigenvalue. So with this, what is the energy will be L square by 2i. So total energy of the hydrogen molecule or otherwise any diatomic molecule energy. So total energy, that is rotational energy. It is the rotational energy. Rotational energy will be given by L square by 2i, that is h square L into L plus 1 by 2i. So I is the moment of inertia and small l will be the orbital quantum number, that will be L equal to 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. Okay, so this is what actually the rotational energy of a hydrogen molecule or any diatomic molecule. In case of hydrogen molecule, the masses will be same, Ma will be equal to Mb. Okay, remember this is the rotational energy of a hydrogen molecule. So we applied the quantum mechanics and we determined the L square eigenvalues, that comes out to be L square L into L plus 1. Okay. Now go for the vibrational energies. Vibrational energy of hydrogen or any diatomic molecule. Okay. So the go for the vibrational energy. Vibrational energy of a hydrogen molecule. Vibrational energy of a hydrogen molecule or any diatomic molecule. Okay, so now the diatomic molecule, again as usual you take, so that diatomic molecule consists of two atoms and you can think of like that they are connected by a spring. This one will have the mass of Ma and this one you call the mass of Mb. K will be the spring constant, effective spring constant, I use the word here. So they are vibrating just like it is a spring model. We can it as a spring model. So vibration energy of a, when I am talking about diatomic molecule. Diatomic molecule, we can treat it as a like a spring model. Okay. So the fine. So we know that given there is a spring, like something, there is a one spring will be there. Let's say for example I have a spring, so one end is fixed to a rigid support, so one end is support, rigid support, so another end will be here, a mass m and spring constant will be k. It is oscillating with an angular frequency, it is given by angular frequency, it is omega will be given by square root of k by m. Okay, this is the angular frequency. If suppose if you want the energy, so the energy, that is a spring energy, amount of energy which will be stored in the form of a spring's potential energy, generally we write half kx square. In place of k, I can write half m omega square x square. The total energy will be also kinetic energy plus potential energy. Let us write for the potential energy. This is the potential energy. This is the potential energy. This is the angular frequency. This you might have learned in your first year of intermediate or first year of BSc. Generally it will come. Okay. So, but in general, if I take a diatomic molecule, the potential energy is not a strictly parabola. It is a strictly parabola. The shape will be the parabola. But generally it is not a strictly parabola. There is an anharmonic nature will be exist. So, for a diatomic molecule, if I write, For a diatomic molecule, if you see the potential energy dependence on the separation R, that will be like this. So the graph of U versus R. the graph of u versus r will be as follows. It will be like this. It will have the minimum potential energy here. For a distance of r naught, it will have the minimum potential energy. This is the potential energy will be minimum here. That is the stable equilibrium point. So it is a like not strictly parabola. It is not a strictly parabola. It shows the asymmetric nature. It is not a strictly parabola. It shows a asymmetric nature. This is not a strictly parabola. Okay, it is not a strictly parabola. This is the asymmetric or as unharmonic nature. Unharmonic nature of the, okay. That harmonic nature that we generally will discuss in the perturbation theory, where treating the term will be as a perturb term. So, okay, that will go for the next chapter. So, for time being, we will model it will be like this only, like the parabola nature like this. Okay, fine. Okay, so the angular frequency and all those things are given by so for this diatomic molecule, so we can calculate the so omega angular frequency, that is omega will be is equal to square root of k by and m. That means here it is a like a spring constant term will come. That spring constant term will come. Here it is a mass term has to come. But in this case, the spring constant can be calculated from the potential energy. That is effective spring constant is given by that effective spring constant is given by effective spring constant is given by d square u by dr square r equal to r. This is the effective spring constant divided by, we need to write the mass term, that is a reduced mass term. Mass of A, mass of B divided by mass of A plus mass of B. So these two things are important, you just remember. So when I, so when, suppose if they are giving the potential energy expression, the dependence of potential energy and the distance r, then from there we can calculate the spring constant, that is d square u by d r square at r is equal to r naught, that is the mean position. Okay. So, and mass term will be the reduced mass term. Mass term will be the reduced mass term. So this is the way of calculating the mean. Then finally come to the energy. So remember, these are the things we are applying when we have the unharmonic nature. So then what about the energy? Energy of vibrational moves. So vibrational energy. So the vibrational energy is given by E is equal to h cross omega into n plus half, where n will be the 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. You remembered, I think, this term. So in the like a harmonic oscillator problem in the quantum mechanics one course, we derived this. Okay, fine. So this is the total energy expression. So in this total energy expression, what is required for us? Omega is required. So the omega can be calculated here. Just now I explained how to calculate that omega. Okay, fine. So this is the way of this is the way of analyzing the vibrational energy of a diatomic molecule. Not necessarily hydrogen molecule, any diatomic molecule you consider. Then we can model, it is like a spring model. through that spring model we can calculate it. It is not completely, so the shape will never come as a parabola shape. Okay, so it is a completely harmonic problem. If it is a harmonicity, generally asymmetric nature will exist, as unharmonic nature will exist. But still, we can calculate what is the omega and what is the total energy, and it looks like that. Okay, fine. I think it is clear. Vibrational energy also. Yeah. Okay, fine. Now let's go. What is the meaning of an ortho and para hydrogen atoms? So a small concept that can be understood very clearly. What is the meaning of ortho and para hydrogens? Ortho and para hydrogen. Ortho hydrogen and para hydrogen. Okay, depending upon the spin of the nuclei, it can be called as an ortho or it can be called as para. So it depending upon the spins, it can exist in the two forms, whether it may be ortho or para form. Let's see what is that. So depending upon the spins of the nuclei, the hydrogen molecule, that I write that point, the molecule of hydrogen, the molecules of hydrogen can exist, so can exist in two forms, can exist in two forms depending on the spins of the two hydrogen nuclei. Two hydrogen nuclei. So let's see what is that. Because it consists of the two electrons and two nuclei, the spins of the nuclei is important here. If both the nuclear spins are parallel, the molecule is called ortho. If both the nuclear spins, if both the nuclear spins are parallel, the molecule is called ortho. And if the spins are anti-parallel, if the spins are anti-parallel, it is referred as para. So remember, be careful here what I am writing. If both the nuclear spins, I am talking about nuclear spins, not electron spins, parallel, then it is ortho. And if the spins are anti-parallel, then it is known as the para position. Okay, so nuclear spins I am talking. If the nuclear spins are parallel, so this is the nuclear spins, proton and proton will be parallel spins. If they are the parallel spins, named it as an ortho condition or an ortho state. Okay, spins are anti-parallel, then we referred it as an a para position. That is, we referred as a para position. This is what actually known as an ortho hydrogen molecule and para hydrogen molecule. So each nuclei is here is a fermion family. So what is the magnitude of the spin of each nuclei? So spin of each nuclei here is h cross by 2. This is the spin of each nuclei. Okay. Now, so anyway, So here once that depending upon the, let's say this is the nucleus, this is the spin of the nucleus here, and the corresponding electron will be here, and another one will be here, that is the spin of that electron, sorry, spin of the hydrogen nuclei, and this is another electron. This is the one state. So another state will be like this. Electron and electron, this is another state. Okay, so both are parallel, that is the ortho condition, and this is the para condition. What happens after half rotation? Generally, after half rotation, the nuclei are superimposed on each other. Since a proton is a spin half nuclei, the total wave function must be, so proton is a spin half kabatti. So total wave function emai undali, the total wave function must be antisymmetric. Okay, fine. Okay, that I write here, the total wave function must be antisymmetric. I'm talking about the total, so it will be consisting of space part, spin part, so the total I am talking about. After half rotation, the nuclei are supposed superimposed on each other. I'll let that point, is an important point here. I'm sorry. After half rotation, the nuclei, are superimposed on each other. Since a proton is a spin half nucleus, the total wave function must be, antisymmetric with respect to exchange of the parity. So after half rotation, see, be careful here what is saying. After half rotation, the nuclei are superimposed on each other. Okay, so since a proton is a spin half nuclei, the total wave function must be antisymmetric with respect to parity, with respect to exchange of the particles. So that means what I can say here, the psi will be of 1,2 is equal to minus of psi 2,1. This is the meaning of antisymmetry. Okay, fine.